thinking about this service this morning. A few weeks ago, I decided to look at the confidential files in our locked, secure closet in the diocesan office to see exactly how Scot McComas had been called. I know with some hesitation, I share with you this very confidential and sensitive report of the church committee to your vestry. Incidentally, what I'm reading to you is the first report. I'll not read the second, third, or the final. And I quote from the confidential report. We do not have, this was to the vestry, we do not have a happy report to give. We've not been able to find a suitable candidate for this church, though we have one promising prospect still. We do appreciate all the suggestions of the church members, and we followed up each one with interviews or calling the references, at least three references. The following is our confidential report on the present candidates that we interviewed. Adam, good man, but problems with wife. Also, one reference told us of how his wife and he enjoyed nude walking in the woods. Noah, former pastor of 120 years with no converts, prone to unrealistic building projects. Abraham, though the references reported wife swapping, the facts seem to show that he never slept with another man's wife, but did offer to share his own wife with another man. Joseph, a big thinker but a braggart, believes in dream interpreting and has a prison record. Moses, a modest and meek man, but poor communicator, even stuttering at times. Sometimes blows his stack and acts rashly. Some say he left an earlier church over a murder charge. David, the most promising leader of all, until we discovered the affair he had with his neighbor's wife. Solomon, a great preacher, but our rectory would never hold all those wives. Elijah, prone to depression, collapses under pressure. Elisha, reported to have lived with a single widow while at a former church. Hosea, a tender and loving pastor, but our people could never handle his wife's occupation. Deborah, female. Jeremiah, emotionally unstable, alarmist, negative always, lamenting things, and reported to have taken a long trip to bury his underwear on the bank of a farm river. Isaiah, on the fringe, claims to have seen angels in church, has trouble with his language. Jonah refused God's call into ministry until he was forced to obey by getting swallowed up by a big fish. He told us the fish later spit him out on the shore near here. We hung up. Amos, too backward and unpolished. With some seminary training, he might have promised, but has a hang-up against wealthy people. Might fit in better in a poor congregation. John says he's a Baptist, but he definitely doesn't dress like one. He slept in the outdoors for months on end and has a weird diet and provokes denominational leaders. Peter, too blue-collar, has a bad temper, even has been known to curse. Had a big run-in with Paul at Antioch, aggressive, a loose cannon. Paul, a powerful CEO-type leader and a fascinating preacher. However, short on tact, unforgiving with young ministers, harsh and has been known to preach all night. Timothy, too young. Jesus had popular times, but once when his church grew to 5,000, he managed to offend them all, and his church dwindled down to 12 people. Seldom stays in one place very long. And of course, he's single. And our last candidate, his references are solid. A steady plotter, conservative, good connections, knows how to handle money. We're inviting him to preach this Sunday. Possibilities here. Oh, by the way, his name is Judas. Well, as I said, there were three other search committee reports that I didn't read. And finally, the search committee offered Scott's name to the vestry, which finally just said, okay, that's fine. I've been given a very unique opportunity to speak to you all here at St. Martin's Church about life and ministry with your new rector together. Not about your new rector doing his work, but doing y'all's work, Jesus' work, together. I have three areas that I would like to think about with you as we consider this new and exciting relationship you all are embarking on together. Ministry in Christ's name. A trust, action, and finally, a word of advice from one who's been there. So we begin with trust. As you all recall, old Joshua, leading the Hebrew people after Moses' death, somewhere after or in the 1200 BC area, has some good words for us this day. Very simple. Be strong and of good courage. Be not frightened, neither be dismayed. But how can a group of wandering people be otherwise as they begin the conquest of an unknown land and against sophisticated and powerful foes? The reason why Joshua said this to that frightened, weak band of Hebrew people was, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. And that assurance was all they needed to have. God is with you. And that translates into trust. Sisters and brothers, we are called to be no less trusting in God and what we attempt to do in this place, in God's holy name. And I am reminding you to do what the ancient Israelites did. Trust in God. Trust God will be with you in all of your ministries together. You need to trust your new rector. He not only has been called by God to this ministry, he has been equipped through his education, through his training, through his experience, and above all, he has been empowered by God's Holy Spirit to lead. Do not ever be afraid to trust yourself. Trust each other in this ministry that you all share. The late Archbishop of Canterbury, William Temple, while a diocesan bishop, used to gather his new clergy together once a year, and he would stress this. He would say that all of you all are hirelings, and whether they would ever become true shepherds would depend on them, on the type of relationship they wanted to have with their people, and on the pastoral relationship their people would allow them to establish. So we become that which we are called to be through trust in God, trust in our leadership, and trust in ourselves. action. What do I mean by this? Well, you know, we're all familiar with that wonderful letter of James saying, be ye doers of the word, not hearers only. That's action. But we timidly ask sometime in our church, how can I, or how can we do such a big thing that we've come up with? Let's not forget those powerful words of Paul in Romans 12 we just heard. He tells us how we are equipped to do ministry. You know, each one of us has been given special gifts to exercise ministry in life through the life around us, through the gifts that each one of us has been given. We all need to come to know what our gifts are and what they are not. And we need the good sense to know when and how to use them. Trust others to help you discover this. A very practical example. Pretty much every time I go to a new church, I'm asked if I will sing the service. And I say, no. I sometimes use an expletive. Because that is a gift that God did not give me. That's a gift that I was passed over. Although I've tried many times to make a gift that I don't have. So remember what your gifts are. Think about what they are and talk to people on how to use them. And I can tell you other stories about gifts that I don't have, but we have a limited amount of time this morning. Romans 12 is a wonderful roadmap for a parish church to look at regularly. We know Jesus was a doer, and he planted seeds which were multiplying a millionfold in the lives of women and men and children down through the centuries. So what kind of seed do you all, congregation and clergy, do you all intend to plant? Are we willing to plant a seed the likes of which have never been seen before? Here at St. Lawrence, what kind of seeds are you going to plant in the years ahead? God and you and your rector will plant, but what will it be? In old age, and none of us are there yet, in old age, are we still planting trees whose shade we will never enjoy or see? That's a challenge. Are we planting seeds which will mature not only in a different time other than ours, but in different places? There's an old Arab saying that I came across years ago. There are only three types of people, three different kinds of people in the world, according to this Arab saying. Those who are immovable, those who can be moved, and those who move themselves. You are called to be people who move themselves and are willing to sow seeds, and harvest of which shall fall to others. In our own individual lives, in our community of the church, there are many occasions where we can be doers of the word, not just hearers. And we never know where a small, simple expression of Christ's care and Christ's love and concern, where that will lead, where that seed will lead. We never know how large a tree may come from a little mustard seed of faith and action. We can change this part of God's world for the better. You and the clergy can do that. And finally, a few thoughts from one who has been a new rector on three different occasions. A clergyman was walking down the street and he happened to pass three little girls, and one of them spoke up and said, "Hello, God." And he was kind of wanted to be sure he heard that. He turned around, and one of the other little girls said, "That's not God, that's just the minister." Well, my friends here at St. Martin's, remember who Scott is. He's not God. He's human. He's just like you all are. Too often we expect our new rector to always say and do the right thing and never be wrong. Here's a truth worth remembering as we embark on this new relationship. The more time that passes, the more that Scott is here, the more he will fail. And the longer you're here, and the longer you are in relationship with Scott, the more you will fail him. And the longer you all are together here in this church, you will fail God. But, thanks be to God, because we are forgiven, and we can forgive each other, and we can move on, even in our failures. Another thought, a word that may not be popular at any time, it's the word patience. Man, are we ready to go? Well, we're going to turn this church around, this community around, and we're going to do it tomorrow. Remember what we've heard so far. God is God, and you and I are humans, and also Scott. And God has given us gifts. Each one has different gifts. Some have been given the gift of leadership, and you trust them. Have a little patience as your leaders listen to you and hear what's on your mind and what your concerns are and what your dreams are and what your hopes are, and pray with you and begin to develop a vision and a plan for St. Martin's. And one final thought. Several years ago, I was asked to speak at an anniversary celebration for a pastor, and it was New Hope Missionary Baptist Church in Waco, where I had been rector of St. Paul's Episcopal Church, and I was asked to say a few words in behalf of the pastor. And as everybody finished up their little pieces of comments and talks, the featured speaker was an older gentleman, a pastor from Houston. And one thing I'll never forget, he said, "Make him a preacher. Make him a preacher." He was talking to the congregation, not to the preacher, or not to the seminary, but to the congregation. "Make him a preacher." Here's what I think he meant. Listen to him each Sunday with belief and conviction that he is truly speaking God's word. Come each Sunday expecting to be touched and changed by the words that Scott preaches that are God's words. And come each Sunday believing you will be so filled with God's Holy Spirit, you will go out of this church and into the world and do something. You expect great things of Scott, and you will make him a preacher. You know, Scott, day by day, week by week, year by year, you will be trying to share your life in Christ with all of these people who are surrounding you this morning. And that's what your primary call is to share your life and your love of Jesus with them. And to the congregation, remember to trust, and remember to be doers of the word. Not that I don't think you are. And be patient. Be patient with Scott, but be patient with each other. And also be patient with God. Let God reveal God's word to you. And together, make him a preacher. Together, rector and parish family, you will be searching for a faith that you can live by, goals you can live for, and the self you can truly have. Honor each other's deepest thoughts and faith as you both try to point to Christ. And together, you all not only will do God's will, but what an exciting and adventurous time you have ahead of you. Thanks be to God for this day and this celebration. Amen.